Okay, welcome back to week three of our class on Americana, cultural phenomena in contemporary American society. So our reading from last week, biographical reading, was Elvis Presley. So let's talk about him in detail. Elvis Aaron Presley, also known simply as Elvis, was an American singer, musician, and actor. He is regarded as one of the most significant cultural icons of the 20th century and is often referred to as the King of Rock and Roll, or simply the King. Elvis was born January 8, 1935, in Tupelo, Mississippi. German, Scots-Irish, French-Norman, and possible Cherokee First Nations ancestry. He had a twin brother that died in childbirth. His father was not very educated and not very ambitious, taking on odd part-time jobs. His father was arrested for writing bad checks and sent to jail for a short time. He was born in a little two-room house. In September 1941, Elvis enters the first grade, where his teachers regarded him as average. He was encouraged to enter a singing contest, and this was his first public appearance. The 10-year-old Presley was dressed as a cowboy. He stood on a chair to reach the microphone, and he recalls placing fifth in the contest. A few months later, he receives his first guitar for his birthday, but he was hoping for something else, either a bicycle or a rifle. 1946, he enters a new school for sixth grade. He is regarded as a loner. The following year, he began bringing his guitar to school on a daily basis. He played and sang during lunchtime and was often teased as a trashy kid who played hillbilly music. He sings on a local radio station in November 1948, and the family moves to Memphis, Tennessee, where he lives in public housing. He goes to high school. He received only a C in music in eighth grade. His music teacher told him he had no aptitude for singing. He was usually too shy to perform openly and was occasionally bullied by his classmates, who viewed him as a mama's boy. He forms a band with two other schoolmates. During his junior year, he begins to stand out among his classmates, largely because of his appearance. He grew his sideburns and styled his hair with rose oil and Vaseline. In his free time, he would head down to Beale Street, which is a famous street in Memphis. And it's the heart of Memphis's thriving blues music scene, and gazed longingly at the wild, flashy clothes in the windows of Lansky Brothers' clothing shop. And by his senior year, he was wearing those clothes. He competes in a local talent show. He recalled that the performance did much for his reputation. quote, "I wasn't popular in school. I failed music, only thing I ever failed. And then they entered me in this talent show. When I came on stage, I heard people kind of rumbling and whispering and so forth, because nobody knew I even sang. It was amazing how popular I became in school after that." Many of his future recordings were inspired by local African-American musicians. B.B. King, famous blues singer, recalled that he had known Elvis before he was popular, when they both used to frequent Beale Street. By the time he graduated from high school in June 1953, Elvis had already decided music as his future. Later that year, he records two songs at a local recording studio as a birthday gift for his mother. It cost $4. During that recording, he gets notice by the recording shop producer. Not a contract, he just gets noticed as being talented. In 1954, he begins working for the Crown Electric Company as a truck driver. One of his co-workers suggests that he contact a local band leader that had an opening for a vocalist. He goes to the audition, he gets rejected. The band leader advises Elvis to stick to truck driving. He says, "Because you're never gonna make it as a singer." A local recording producer wanted to find a white singer who could sing African-American music. Through a long, convoluted story, the producer and Elvis finally meet. Elvis would move in an awkward way while singing, and the crowd went wild. He gets a recording contract and meets this guy who calls himself Colonel, not a real Colonel, Colonel Tom Parker, who becomes his manager. More about him later. Eventually, Elvis gets some national television airtime. He records Heartbreak Hotel, his first smash hit, which became a number one pop song. He becomes a teen idol of his generation, greeted everywhere by screaming hordes of young women. And when it was announced in early 1958 that he had been drafted and would enter the U.S. Army, which he does. He's in the Army and finishes up his tour of duty in 1960. He had served as a soldier in Germany. He could have joined something called Special Services and an entertainment division within the military, but he turned it down. He just wanted to be a regular soldier. And he returns to the United States, and he kind of picks up pretty much where he left off. And he turns out a series of songs and more than 30 movies over the next 8 years. None of which fit in any particular genre other than what is called today an Elvis movie, which was light, comedic, romance with musical interludes. Most of the movies had an accompanying soundtrack album, And together with the movies and the records made him a very rich man. Although they nearly ruined him as any kind of musical artist. He buys a mansion at age 22 in Memphis, Tennessee, and he names it Graceland. His career, like all musical careers, starts shares of ups and downs, and he becomes a sort of a recluse in his mansion home, Graceland, and his health declines basically through a poor diet, and he starts taking prescription drugs. He dies at the age of 42, heart issues brought on by poor diet and drug abuse. Immediately upon hearing of his death, mourners from around the world gathered at Graceland to say farewell to the poor boy who had lived out the American dream. In a way, that mourning has never ceased. Graceland remains one of the country's top tourist attractions, and Presley's albums and other artifacts continue to sell even today. A few unusual facts about Elvis. He used shoe polish to color his hair, which was naturally brown. He was a germaphobe. He was very afraid of getting sick and ill. He never played outside the United States. A couple concerts in Canada, but other than that, he never played outside the United States. This goes back to his manager, Colonel Parker, who was an illegal immigrant. And he was afraid that if he went outside the country and he came back in, that he wouldn't be able to actually come back in because he was illegal. Parker was kind of a sleazy guy. But he did promote Elvis to get famous. But it cost Elvis a lot of money to do that. There's some financial scandals connected with Colonel Parker. He records 600 songs, but he never wrote any of them. He starred in 30 movies. His only child, Lisa Marie, marries Michael Jackson. That doesn't last very long. And then she marries an American actor, Nicolas Cage. According to some reports, sometime around 1968, Elvis took a walk down a busy Los Angeles street, and nobody recognized him. Nobody knew who he was. He had lost all his fame and notoriety. Elvis met President Nixon in the Oval Office of the White House, and he had an odd request for the president. He asked the president if he would grant him a badge as a narcotics agent. This seemed like an outrageous request, except for the fact that the President Nixon gave it to him, which, despite his lack of training, actually proved to be a bad idea. Why? Because giving Elvis a badge, he loved to dress up as a police officer and pull people, mainly women, over just to give them his autograph. He was an inspiration literally to thousands of musicians. Initially, those more or less like-minded Southern musicians seeking fame and copying his style. So that's a little bit about our reading, Elvis Presley. And we're going to get back to our lesson on the regional areas and characteristics and culture in America on the next slide. Okay, so back to our regional areas of the United States and some of their culture and characteristics. And just south of the Deep South is a very small, unique area of America. It's called New France. And if you take a look at our map, you can see that New France is not only in the very south of the United States, but also connects to a region in Canada, a province called Quebec. There's a very deep historical reason for that. Of course, remembering that France was one of the major players in early North American colonial history. And as a result of the treaties after what was called French and Indian Wars, which was really nothing more than probably the First World War between England and France. They had been fighting each other for a while in Europe and brought that fight to North America. So at the British win, barely, and the treaties that were drawn up during that colonial time created some French areas that were still left after those treaties were signed. So Quebec in Canada is a French-speaking province. Part of the reason why in Canada there are two national languages, English and French. And there is this really peculiar little island off the coast of Newfoundland called St. Pierre Marguerite in North America, which is actually French territory. You could go there today. There are the French gendarmes, which are the police force of France. I mean, it's a French colony in the middle of North America that still exists today. Okay, so back to our area, New France in America. This is the area that surrounds New Orleans. And a heavy pocket in early colonial times of French. So New France is a little pocket of liberalism nestled in the Deep South. Its people are consensus driven, they're very tolerant, and they're comfortable with government involvement in the economy. Our author, Woodward, says New France is among the most liberal places in North America. New France is focused around New Orleans in Louisiana, as well as the Canadian province in Quebec, which we just talked about. So New Orleans is nearly 300 years old. It's a mix of African-American, French, Spanish, and Caribbean traditions to create unique forms of music, food, and culture found nowhere else in America. The key part of Louisiana culture finds its roots in the French period. Creole songs influenced the blues and jazz, and Creole is a kind of a mixed language of English, French, African, kind of all combined into one to make its own very unique language and other cultural items. They're called Cajun. Cajun music is often sung in the French language and remains very much alive today. New Orleans is famous for its carnival season with its height on a day called Mardi Gras. And this just testifies to a long-lived Roman Catholic heritage. The Cajun people are among one of the most unique cultures and ethnic groups in the United States, primarily located in rural southern Louisiana. The culture is defined by its French roots, which are easily seen in their own distinct Cajun French dialect, societal norms, music, and food. The main musical instrument of Cajun music is the fiddle, which is a kind of violin. And gradually, another instrument called the accordion has come to share the limelight with the fiddle. Cajun music gained national attention in 2007 when the Grammy Awards created a category especially for Cajun music. The holiday of Mardi Gras, famous. Thousands and thousands of people go to New Orleans to celebrate the Carnival of Mardi Gras. Easter is also a huge holiday celebrated in Louisiana. A song called Mississippi Queen in 1970 by a group called Mountain is about a Cajun woman visiting from Mississippi. A dish called jambalaya is a one-pot Creole dish. Browned meat. Another food is called gumbo, and it can be traced back for centuries. It usually has a lot of Cajun staples and green onions and rice. Of course, the area is famous for jazz music. A kind of jazz started there called Dixieland. Also, rhythm and blues and rock and roll. So, New Orleans, Louisiana area is easily the jazz music mecca. Louis Armstrong, a famous trumpet player, was among some of the city's most celebrated jazz musicians who helped to pioneer the genre. An area within the city is called the French Quarter, and it's known for its French and Spanish Creole architecture, and a vibrant nightlife along a famous street called Bourbon Street. New Orleans is also known for a kind of offbeat religion called the Voodoo Catholicism. It's a religion connected to nature, spirits, ancestors. It came from when people in Haiti, a nearby Caribbean island, left Haiti during a slave revolt in 1791, moved to New Orleans and brought their religion with them. It's still practiced today. It's you'll see it in the streets and shops. So a couple of movies that really depict and were shot on location in New Orleans. One of the more famous is a movie called JFK. And it was directed by American film director, screenwriter, and producer Oliver Stone. It's a historical legal conspiracy thriller that examines how a district attorney in New Orleans, played by Kevin Costner, discovers that there are more details to the Kennedy assassination than the official story suggests. It's an adaptation from two books, one of them called On the Trail of the Assassins by the district attorney, whose name is Jim Garrison, and another book called Crossfire, The Plot That Killed Kennedy by Jim Mars. The film was very controversial in American newspapers. They claim that Stone was taking liberties with historical facts, including President Lyndon Johnson's implication in the Kennedy murders. However, it earned $200 million in worldwide gross sales. It won two Academy Awards and earned Oliver Stone a Golden Globe for Best Director. Another movie called A Streetcar Named Desire, filmed on location in New Orleans, starred an unknown actor of the time named Marlon Brando. And this really put Brando's career, heightened his work and future as an actor. The nickname for New Orleans is called the Big Easy, which became the set in New Orleans about a detective who falls in love with a district attorney. The nickname may be a reference to the easy and of new struggling musicians to find work, or it could be a reference to how easy it was to get alcohol during Prohibition. So during the Prohibition times, of course, alcohol is illegal everywhere in the United States, except New Orleans, which it was illegal, but nobody paid attention. And the police just didn't enforce the law. Some famous people you may know from New Orleans. Truman Capote, famous American author, as well as William Faulkner. Tennessee Williams, a playwright. Clay Shaw was a businessman, the only person brought to court in connection to the assassination of JFK. Carlos Marcello was a businessman and a mafia boss headquartered in New Orleans. Lee Harvey Oswald, the assassin in the JFK case, was from New Orleans. Sandra Bullock, the actress, resident of New Orleans, as well as Ellen DeGeneres, and who was a famous talk show host. So we have a little short video taking you on a little tour through New Orleans. Very unique, interesting, cultural, hidden cultural part of America. Hope you enjoy, and we'll move on to our next geographic area called El Norte. Okay, our next segment is called El Norte, and it is the dominant Hispanic culture that influences America today. And it's composed of the borderlands of the Spanish-American Empire. It's a place apart from the rest of America. And according to our author, Woodward, Hispanic culture dominates in the area, and the region values independence, self-sufficiency, and hard work above all else. It includes parts of Texas, Arizona, New Mexico, California, are all in the area called El Norte. So way back in 1598, New Mexico was settled by the Spanish, making it the largest and oldest Spanish settlement in the Southwest. So some of its cultural influences that we can see today. In art, they're called sugar skulls. And the skulls are traditionally made of molded sugar and then painted in vibrant colors and patterns. The sugar skulls have become extremely popular in both art and fashion in America, especially around the Halloween season. They are a traditional part of a Mexican holiday called the Day of the Dead, which is a holiday honoring deceased loved ones in Mexico. So the skulls showing up in America in many forms as masks or handicrafts, tattoos, costumes, and art pieces, to name a few. So let's look at some fashion trends inspired by Mexican culture. One is a special kind of design cloth. It's called lace and embroidery. The fashion of wearing lingerie as outerwear and other romantic styles. Female pop artists really promoting that. Ruffles and frills. Designers like Oscar de la Renta and Michael Kors use this in their fashion designs. The bare shoulder look, off the shoulder outfits, are reminiscent of flamingo inspired outfits. Flamingo dancing is a famous Spanish dance. About 17 to 20% of the population is are Hispanic in America. Let's see, one of the famous musicians that really kind of put Spanish music into mainstream rock and roll was an artist named, stage name, Richie Valens. His real name was Richard Stephen Valenzuela. He was born in 1941, and he dies in 1959. Known professionally as Richie Valens, was an American singer, songwriter, and guitarist. A rock and roll pioneer, and a forefather of the Chicano rock movement. Valens was killed in an airplane crash 8 months into his recording career. He had several hits. Number one was a song called La Bamba, which was a mix of English and Spanish language. And it was adapted from an old Mexican folk song. And Valens transformed that song into one with a rock rhythm and beat. It became a big hit in the late 50s, early 60s. And his number two song was a song called Donna. On February 3rd, 1959, what has become known as the day the music died. Valens died in a plane crash in Iowa, an accident that also claimed the lives of fellow musician Buddy Holly, and the Big Bopper, two other rock and roll singers. They had just finished a performance and had to get to the next performance, snowstorm. They had one seat left in the plane. Richie was kind of afraid of flying, but he took them up on the offer to take that spare seat, and it didn't end well for all of them. Another influential musician is Carlos Santana, which we talked about at length in our previous series of videos. A female singer, Selena Perez, born in 1971, passes away in 1995. She was an American singer, songwriter, spokesperson, businesswoman, model, actress, and a fashion designer. She was referred to as the queen of Tejano music, and her contributions to music and fashion made her one of the most celebrated Mexican-American entertainers of the late 20th century. Billboard magazine named her the top-selling Latin artist of the 1990s. Media outlets called her the Tejano Madonna for her clothing choices. And she ranks among the most influential Latin artists of all time and is credited for placing the music genre into the mainstream market. For television, ABC is a big television network, and they took a what's called a telenovela dramedy. And a dramedy is a comic drama. And they created this TV program called Ugly Betty. And it ran for 4 seasons. And in the past few years, 3 English language shows have been based on the same telenovela format. One of them is called Queen of the South. So you can see that Spanish influence in even English language television programming. But in America, there are several, but the biggest one is called Univision. Is a Spanish language all day television programming. And it has grown immensely in the United States. One of the reasons is that it does show soccer. It's a huge industry, and it's considered the most popular Spanish language television network in America. They promoted soccer, which made it hugely successful. In the food, we have Mexican food is more popular than ever in American diets. It has definitely gone mainstream over the past 20 years and will continue to grow according to food industry and experts. There is kind of a McDonald's version of Mexican food. It's called Taco Bell, and you can find it all across America. Hugely popular. People are kind of trading in or as a replacement for bread and buns. What's become hugely popular is something called wraps. And wraps are really tortillas, which comes from Mexico. Believe it or not, $2 billion a year in the U.S. alone just last year for the sales of tortillas. Another kind of interesting statistic is baby names. 30% of the top 10 names were Latino names, mostly for girls. Frida, Amia, Naya, Nova, Aminia considered the some of the top Hispanic girl names. Also, Sophia and Isabella. The Spanish language is gaining popularity in the United States as a second or third language to be learned. It's basically in every high school as a language option and probably the most favored choice of high school students in USA is Spanish. In terms of party culture, there is this from Mexico. They take a paper, it's called paper mache, and it's made of thick paper in layers, pasted together, usually formed in the shape of an animal. And at the party, the piñata, it's called a piñata, is hung up, and the contestant or the party goer is blindfolded. It has a stick, and they have to go find the piñata, and they try to hit it, and inside is filled with candies and sweets. It's for kids' birthday parties, that sort of thing. Another day is a popular party for girls, 15th birthday party. It's kind of a coming out into the adult world that's become popular. And another one is called Cinco de Mayo. It's a giant celebration in the United States, especially in those states that we mentioned, Texas, Arizona, New Mexico, California. And it's a celebration holiday held on May 5th to observe Mexican Army's victory over the French Empire. There's a kind of a fictional character, movies, TV programs, comic books, radio stories, and his name was Zorro. And the story is set during the era of Spanish California from 1769 to 1821. And it's a character that goes by the name of Zorro. And Zorro in Spanish means fox, like the animal fox. And it's a fictional character created in 1919 by an American pulp fiction writer, Johnston McCauley. And he's kind of a dashing, masked vigilante who defends the common man and indigenous peoples of California against the corrupt, tyrannical officials and other villains. And his signature is an all-black costume, including a cape and a black hat. And he wears a mask on the upper half of his face, so nobody can know who he is. He has a bounty on his head. The officials don't like him. But he's very skilled and cunning, and he fools the bumbling authorities who try to catch him. And he delights in publicly humiliating them. Because of this, the townspeople started calling him El Zorro due to his fox-like cunning and charm. He's an acrobat. He's an expert in various weapons. But the one he uses most is his sword, which he uses to carve the initial Z on his defeated foes and other objects to sign his work. He's also an accomplished horseback rider, riding his trusty steed, of course, a black horse called Tornado. So Zorro's been around for a long time in many different formats. So as you can see, there are many ways that American culture has been influenced by Mexico. Everything from sports, fashion, baby names, and how Americans party. So that's our little piece on El Norte, and we will move on to the Far West in our next slide. Okay, so our next slide, we're going to talk about the regional area of the Far West. The conservative West developed through large investment in industry, yet where inhabitants continue to resent the Eastern interest that initially controlled that investment. The Far West spans several states, including Idaho, Montana, Wyoming, Utah, Nevada, Nebraska, Kansas, Arizona, New Mexico, Colorado, North and South Dakota, Washington, Oregon, and California. So the first thing we're going to look at is from biography.com. It's entitled 10 Iconic Wild West Figures. These famous outlaws ruled the American frontier, by Udy Park. So in the 1860s and the 1890s gave birth to the period known as the Wild West and laid a foundation for its ensuing mythology. It was an era of cowboys, Indians, pioneers, outlaws, gunslingers, brought together by the purpose of expansion, defense, greed, and reinvention. So we're going to explore some of these legendary outlaws from the Old West. And our first one is very well known, Billy the Kid. While not much is known of Billy the Kid's early years, he was born William Henry McCarthy Jr. in the slums of New York City and was orphaned at the age of 14. He eventually moved out west, where his days as a Wild West outlaw and gunfighter was ripe before him. On the lam from New Mexican authorities for stealing, Billy the Kid fled to Arizona, where he murdered a man during a fight. He returned to New Mexico and joined a group of cattle thieves and fought in the Lincoln County War. Although he boasted of having gunned down close to 24 men, he probably killed less than 10 before he was fatally shot at the age of 21 by Sheriff Pat Garrett. Next is Buffalo Bill. William F. Buffalo Bill Cody lived many lives before he became known to the world for his famous Wild West tour. Barely a teen, he took part in California's gold rush, and 2 years later became a Pony Express rider. He served as an Army scout in the Indian Wars, fought for the Union in the Civil War, and found a way of practicing his acting in between. By the time he launched his colorful cowboy-themed Wild West show in 1883, he was already a legend. Our next person is Davy Crockett. Easily identifiable by his coonskin cap, so that's a hat made out of an animal called a raccoon, had a long black and brown and white tail, very popular in the 50s, all the young boys had a coonskin cap. Davy Crockett was known for being a hunter, frontiersman, soldier, and politician, is one of the most mythologized folk heroes and forefathers of the Wild West. Called King of the Wild Frontier, Davy Crockett got involved in Tennessee's local and state politics before representing it as a U.S. congressman in 1827 to 1833. After barely losing his election to serve out a fourth term, a disillusioned Crockett moved to Texas, which was under Mexico's jurisdiction at the time. In 1835, the following year, he fought for Texas independence and was killed in the Battle of the Alamo. Our next person, a woman frontiers lady called Calamity Jane. She was born Martha Jane Canary in Missouri. Calamity Jane grew up to be an adventurous frontiersman and performer. Famous for dressing and shooting like a man and drinking like one too. Jane moved to booming gold rush towns out west and became an expedition scout in South Dakota. She became famous for her wild antics and quickly learned that telling tall tales of her exploits, real and mostly imagined, could help her make money. Jane toured with Buffalo Bill's Wild West show and also appeared at the 1901 Pan American Exposition in upstate New York. Her rumored romantic relations with Wild Bill Hickok were probably started by her. But soon, even she tired of her fanciful stories and persona. Suffering from alcoholism, Jane died at age 51. Per her request, she was buried next to Hickok. So that leads us to Wild Bill Hickok. Like Calamity Jane, Wild Bill Hickok was known for telling outlandish tales about his adventures out west. He was a wagon master, union spy, lawman, gunslinger, and gambler, who became cemented as one of the most famous folk heroes of the era. Thanks to his quick draw duel with Davis Tutt in 1865. While playing a game of poker in Deadwood, Dakota Territory, Hickok was shot in the back by Jack McCall. At the time of his death, he was purportedly holding two pairs of black aces and eights, now known as the dead man's hand in poker. Annie Oakley, called Miss Sure Shot, among many other names. Ohio native Annie Oakley lived an extraordinary life thanks to her champion shooting skills, which started in her teens. At 15, her talents came out in full view when she dared to compete with expert marksman Frank E. Butler, whom she narrowly beat in a shooting contest and eventually married. Later, she'd meet Buffalo Bill, become one of his star attractions in his Wild West show, where she had the opportunity to meet royalty, world leaders, and even befriend Chief Sitting Bull. Even up to her death, Oakley was setting records in shooting contests and preparing for a comeback. She died in 1926. Her husband of five decades was so devastated that he followed her to the grave just a few weeks later. Butch Cassidy. Robert Leroy Parker, better known as Butch Cassidy, closed out the last decade of the 1800s being a wanted man, with his accomplice, Harry Alonzo Legorba, also known as Sundance Kid. The two robbed trains, banks, and led a posse of criminals called the Wild Bunch. Cassidy and the Wild Bunch wreaked havoc in places like Idaho, Utah, Wyoming, and New Mexico before fleeing the country to invade law enforcement. To make a clean escape, Cassidy and the Sundance Kid traveled from New York City to South America. In 1908, they got involved in a shootout with local authorities in the country of Bolivia and it is believed that the two men lost their lives there. Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid is a famous Western movie, and we have a short clip of that. You can find that in the description box below or in the email I sent you. Okay, next is an outlaw named Jesse James. Like Butch Cassidy and Sundance Kid, Jesse James was another celebrated bank and train robber who, along with his brother Frank, led the James Younger Gang. The James brothers fought for the Confederate Army during the Civil War and were accused of atrocious crimes against Union soldiers and abolitionists, robbing banks, trains, and stagecoaches throughout the Midwest. James gained celebrity status and notoriety starting in 1866. After close to two decades on the run, James's life of crime came to an end when he was shot by a new gang recruit, Robert Ford, who was promised by authorities to be forgiven for his past crimes if he killed James. Next is Wyatt Earp. Wyatt Earp was a complicated frontiersman who lived many lives, both savory and unsavory. Not only was he a businessman, brothel bouncer, and gambler, but he had a few run-ins with the law before deciding to become the law. After moving from one boomtown to the next in search of easy money, he found himself in Dodge City, Kansas, as an assistant marshal, where he would spend his days maintaining the peace and doing his fair share of gambling. In 1879, he and several of his brothers moved to Tombstone, Arizona territory, hoping to get rich from the silver boom. While there, they found trouble waiting for them. A group of outlaws called the Cowboys. Soon the Earp brothers, along with friend Doc Holliday, would become legendary for their shootout with the Cowboys at the OK Corral in 1881. Doc Holliday. John Henry Doc Holliday was born and raised in Georgia before he became a professional gambler and gunslinger out west. He became a dentist who built his career in Atlanta, Georgia. Having caught tuberculosis from his ailing mother, Holliday decided to move to the Southwest in hopes that the drier climate would ease his symptoms. Like Wyatt Earp, Doc Holliday was a drifter and risk taker. Realizing playing poker was more lucrative than dentistry, he became a gambler and traveled westward. Texas, Wyoming, Colorado, New Mexico, and Arizona. It was in Texas he met Wyatt Earp, and the two became lifelong friends. Holliday would eventually follow Earp to Tombstone, Arizona, and fight side by side with him at the OK Corral. At age 36, Doc Holliday succumbed to tuberculosis in California. Here's a short movie clip from the movie Tombstone with Doc Holliday and Wyatt Earp. Okay, something that has become part of popular American culture is cowboy clothing. And here's an article by Laurel E. Wilson. And she says, cowboys, vaqueros, gauchos. Each of these words conjures a different image. Yet all these occupations originated in Salamanca and Old Castile region of the 12th century Spain, where cattle herders wore low-crowned hats, bolero jackets, sashes, tight-fitting trousers, and spurred boots. The cowboy hat is a hat with a high crown, wide brim, best known as the defining piece of attire for the North American cowboy. Today it is worn by many people and is particularly associated with ranch workers in the West and Southern United States, Western Canada, and Northern Mexico. With many country music performances and with participants in North American rodeo circuit, it is recognized around the world as part of Old West apparel. The cowboy hat was known today has many antecedents to its design, including Mexican hats such as the sombrero, with various designs of wide-brimmed hat worn by farmers and stockmen in eastern United States, as well as the designs used by the United States military cavalry. The concept of a broad-brimmed hat with a high crown worn by a rider on horseback can be seen as far back as the Mongolian horsemen of the 13th century. It is not clear when the cowboy hat received its name. However, European Americans in the Western United States originally had no standard headwear. People moving west wore many styles of hats, including top hats, bowlers, remains of Civil War headgear, and sailor hats. Contrary to popular belief, it was the bowler, not the cowboy hat, that was the most popular in the American West. The cowboy hat was most likely adopted from American Mexican vaqueros before the invention of the modern design. Blue jeans. Jeans are a type of pants or trouser typically made of denim or dungaree cloth. Often the term jeans refers to a particular style of trouser called blue jeans, which is invented by Jacob W. Davis in partnership with Levi Strauss & Company in 1871. Originally designed for gold miners, modern jeans were popularized as casual wear by Marlon Brando and James Dean in their 1950s films, particularly The Wild One and Rebel Without a Cause, leading to the fabric becoming a symbol of rebellion among teenagers, especially members of the greaser subculture. From the 1960s onward, jeans became common among various youth subcultures and subsequently young members of the general population. Today, they are one of the most popular types of specialty trousers in Western culture. Historic brands include Levi's, Lee, and Wrangler. The chuck wagon. A chuck wagon is a type of field kitchen covered wagon historically used for the storage and transportation of food and cooking equipment on the prairies of the United States and Canada. Such wagons formed part of a wagon train of settlers or fed traveling workers, such as cowboys or loggers. In modern times, chuck wagons featured a certain cooking competition and events. Chuck wagons are also used in a type of horse racing known as chuck wagon racing. Chuck wagon food typically included easy to prepare items like beans and salted meats, coffee, and sourdough biscuits. On cattle drives, it was common for the cookie who ran the wagon to be second in authority only to the trail boss. The cookie would often act as cook, barber, dentist, and banker. We've got a short little video clip about chuck wagons on the Chisholm Trail. Okay, so eventually the Wild West becomes a subject for movies. And the early movies were called spaghetti westerns. And they were called that for two reasons. One, most of the directors of the early westerns were Italian. And they were shot on location in Italy because it was cheaper than filming them in USA. Spaghetti westerns have left their mark on popular culture, strongly influencing numerous works produced outside of Italy. One actor whose career in film started with spaghetti westerns was Clint Eastwood. Here's a short clip from a movie filmed in Italy starring Clint Eastwood called A Few Dollars More. Another famous cowboy actor, his real name was Marion Robert Morrison, and known professionally as John Wayne, and nicknamed Duke, was an American actor and filmmaker who became a popular icon through his starring roles in Western films. His career spanned from the silent era of the 1920s through the golden age of Hollywood and eventually American New Wave, appearing in a total of 179 films and television productions. He was among the top box office draws for three decades and appeared with many important Hollywood stars of his era. He starred in 142 motion pictures altogether. According to one biographer, John Wayne personified for millions the nation's frontier heritage. He was awarded the Presidential Medal of Freedom, the highest civilian honor of the United States. Here's a short clip from a movie, one of his more famous roles, called True Grit. So another cultural feature throughout the West is the rodeo. And it's a competitive equestrian sport that arose out of the working practices of cattle herding in Spain and Mexico, expanding throughout the Americas into other nations. It was based on the skills required of the working cowboy in what today is the Western United States and Western Canada in Northern Mexico. It's also in Brazil as well. Today, it is a sporting event that involves horses and other livestock designed to test the skill and speed of the cowboys and cowgirls. American rodeo, particularly popular today within the Canadian provinces of Alberta and throughout Western United States, is the official state sport of Wyoming, South Dakota, and Texas. The iconic silhouette image of a bucking horse and a rider is a federal and state registered trademark of the state of Wyoming. So here's a short video clip showing the rodeo and some of the contests that are part of it. Okay, so Western culture has also added a special kind of dancing. It comes from the West. It's called line dancing. Country and Western dance, also called line dancing, encompasses many dance forms or styles, which are typically a dance to country Western music, which are stylistically associated with American country and or Western traditions. Many of these dancers were tried and true dance steps that have been put aside for many years and became popular under the name country Western cowboy or country dancing. It's also known as kicker dancing in Texas. So here's a short video clip on cowboy dancing. It's called a line dance. There for First Nations, the largest powwow gathering of First Nations dancing and music performances is called the Gathering of Nations. It's the largest in the United States and North America. And it's held every year on the fourth weekend in April in Expo, New Mexico, in Albuquerque. Over 565 tribes from around the United States and 220 tribes from Canada travel to Albuquerque to participate. There are 36 dance categories. Other competitions include Northern singers, Southern singers, women's backup singing, and competition for drum groups. A pageant for Miss Indian World is held each year. The winner is chosen based upon personality, knowledge of tribal traditions, and dancing ability. There is also the Indian Traders Market featuring artists, crafters, and traders selling Native American and Indigenous arts and crafts. So here's a short video clip of that powwow. So finally, we have music. Western music is a form of country music composed by and about the people who settled and worked throughout the Western United States and Western Canada. Western music celebrates the lifestyle of the cowboy on the open ranges, Rocky Mountains, and the prairies of Western North America. Directly related musically to Old English, Irish, Scottish, and folk ballads, also Mexican folk music of Northern Mexico and Southwestern United States, influenced the development of this genre. So we have a couple of songs for you. GLEN CAMPBELL, a famous country Western singer, sings a song called Wichita Lineman. So not all songs are about cowboys. A lineman is the person that fixes the wires of the telegraph or telephone or those high energy wires that string across the prairie. It's a simple tale of a lonely telephone repairman working in the vast open plains of the American Midwest. Wichita Lineman is one of the most perfectly realized pop songs of all time. So take a listen to GLEN CAMPBELL, Wichita Lineman. Okay, so our next Western music song is sung by Paula Cole. And it's entitled, Where Have All the Cowboys Gone? And it glamorizes cowboys, the strong, silent, rugged macho man in a Stetson hat has always been a powerful image. Women wanted to marry a John Wayne or a Gary Cooper, while men wanted to be John Wayne or Gary Cooper. Paula Cole is singing about the reality behind that image. The narrator of the song fell in love with a rugged, macho, rural male and married him, and only then learned that life with the real cowboy isn't so glamorous after all. Cowboys, ranchers, and farm workers in rural America don't make a lot of money. So she and her husband are barely scraping by financially. They had to sell their car, and he takes a job at a farm far away. So she's left to raise the children by herself, working her fingers to the bone, while her husband drinks away the little money he earns. She's left wondering, what happened to the man I idolized? I thought he was going to be the kind of romantic cowboy I saw in the movies. But there's nothing romantic or glamorous about this life at all. The video ends on a happier note. They resolve their issues and come together in the end. A quick note about Paula Cole. She was raised in Massachusetts and studied at Berklee College of Music in Boston. Okay, so we have a short video clip of Paula Cole's song, Where Have All the Cowboys Gone? So take a look at that. And our third song is a standard. It's been around for quite a while. Everybody knows it. It's entitled Rocky Mountain High, written and sung by John Denver. John Denver's more of a kind of a folk music singer. This takes on a Western theme. Rocky Mountain High is primarily inspired by John Denver's move to Aspen, Colorado. It took him about 3 years to write the song, and it's about his love of the state. The seventh stanza makes a reference to the destruction of the mountain's beauty by commercial tourism. The song was considered a major piece of 1970s pop culture and has become well associated with Colorado history. After years as an unofficial anthem for Colorado, in 2007, the Colorado General Assembly made Rocky Mountain High one of the two official state songs. Okay, so that basically wraps up our Far West introduction, and it's purely an introduction. There is so much there going on. It's a good area to think about for your research paper. So we have one small little discussion to wrap up our regional areas, and that's the American territories. America has several territories, both in the Caribbean and the Atlantic side, and in the Pacific side. The territories are American Samoa, Guam, and the Northern Mariana Islands. So this is a Polynesian culture. And in the Caribbean, our two main territories are Puerto Rico and the U.S. Virgin Islands. So we talked at length about Puerto Rican influence in our American Lit 4 class. And the U.S. Virgin Islands is really a small, small little island. It's kind of a tourist place now, beautiful beaches. But in the Pacific, we haven't really talked about those islands per se. They are very closely related to the Polynesian culture of Hawaii. And we did talk about that at length as well. So recently in popular culture has shown tattoos, tattoos, that ink drawing on the skin. And right now it's really popular with the rock singers and so forth is the Polynesian style of tattooing, usually a around the arm, a band around the arm, with Polynesian style and design. And to the Polynesian culture, those tattoos represent maybe your standing in the society or some positive cultural trait, bravery, warrior type of thing, that sort of stuff. So a little history behind the tattoos. This guy, Captain Cook, explorer, he explores the Polynesian area, and he brings back the word tattoo to Europe. And with him, of course, he dies in Hawaii, but his shipmates return back to England, and they bring with them a Tahitian native named Maya. And he is covered with the Polynesian style tattoo. And tattoo, the word, and the style becomes famous in Europe. The Polynesian tattoos were became popular with European sailors who would return home from their voyages with their bodies decorated with these tattoos. So that's one small aspect that our territories in the Pacific have added to American pop culture. So that's about it for today. We've basically run out of time again. Take a look at your email for your assignments, and have a great weekend. And until then, thank you. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you again next week. Okay, thanks. Goodbye.